Hello, welcome to this lecture on frequency response function matrices with modal superposition. This lecture is part of the course Dynamics and Control of Mechanical Systems. Let me start with a short recap. In the lecture about frequency response functions of multi-degree of freedom undamped systems, we saw that when the system is in a steady state and we can consider that the excitation is a harmonic excitation and then the response is also harmonic, we substitute them in the equation of motion and we obtain an equation of motion in frequency domain that relates the complex amplitude of the generalized coordinates to the complex amplitude of generalized forces. And this matrix here is the frequency response function matrix, which is a function of the stiffness matrix of the system and the mass matrix of the system. So this is an expression for the frequency response function matrix, which is very useful when we are building a model for the system. But it doesn't really give us insight in the dynamic response of the system. So what we will do in this lecture is derive an alternative expression for the frequency response function matrix that helps us understand better how the dynamics of the system show up in this frequency response function matrix. And to do that, we need to recall another concept we learned, and that's the principle of modal superposition, which says that we can write generalized coordinates as the matrix of eigenmodes times a set of modal coordinates. And if we substitute this in the equation of motion and pre-multiply it with U transpose, we saw that we end up with a set of uncoupled scalar equations, which is shown here with MR, the modal mass, KR, the modal stiffness, and capital N, the modal force. If we continue with this set of uncoupled equations and we consider that the modal force is harmonic, then we can write it as well as a cosinus term or in a more general form as the real part of an amplitude mal and times an exponential. So we end up having this representation where the complex amplitude has a magnitude and a phase. If we then substitute the harmonic expression of the modal forces in the uncoupled set of scalar equations, the modal coordinates are also harmonic. And then we need to consider that this expression should hold for any time step, so for any point in time. Then we can eliminate the exponential factors and we end up finding a relationship between the complex amplitude of the modal coordinates and the complex amplitude of the modal forces. And this term here is the modal frequency response function. Let's continue working with this in the next slide. So this modal frequency response function, H of eta, we can continue to derive the expression if we recall that the modal stiffness is equal to the modal mass times the eigenfrequency squared. So if we substitute that in the expression above and we take the modal mass out, then we end up with this expression for the modal frequency response function, where we have eigenfrequency squared minus excitation frequency squared between brackets. So here it becomes very clear that when the excitation frequency is equal to the eigenfrequency, this term goes to zero and the frequency response goes to infinity. So the system is at resonance. This is what we call a resonance. To clarify this expression, let me just plot it for you. So say we take modal mass is 1, modal stiffness is 100, and the eigenfrequency is then 10 radians per second, and we make a plot in a double logarithmic scale with the excitation frequency in the x-axis and the magnitude in the y-axis, then we find exactly what we found for the frequency response function of a 1 degree of freedom system. So we have a horizontal line as the frequency goes to zero, we have response goes to infinity at the idle frequency, and then for higher frequencies, the response goes to zero. Of course, we have more than one modal coordinate, so we put our modal coordinates in a column, and we can relate them to the modal forces through the modal frequency response function matrix. And this modal frequency response function matrix looks like this. So what we do is we put each of these frequency response, modal frequency response functions in a diagonal. And with this, we have the modal frequency response function matrix. So outside of the diagonal, we only have zeros. But this matrix gives us the relationship between modal coordinates and modal forces. And what we want to find is the relationship between generalized forces and generalized coordinates. So let us do that. And we need to use the things we learned up to now. So we need to use the expression of modal superposition, the relationship between modal forces and generalized forces, and the expression we derived just yet relating the modal coordinates to the modal forces. So we start with the modal superposition expression. We substitute this expression here. Then we substitute the expression of the modal forces there. And we end up having a compact expression for the frequency response function matrix. Let me show you what this is by writing this matrix multiplication as a sum. And to do that, we need to recall that the eigenmode matrix is a matrix with the eigenmodes as columns. And if we use this, we end up having the following representation. The frequency response function matrix is the sum for r is 1 to n, with n the number of degrees of freedom, which is also the number of modes, of the modal frequency response functions, that's this part, times the eigenmode, times the eigenmode transpose. And then if we have mass normalized eigenmodes, the modal mass is 1, and we end up having this expression where the modal frequency response function matrix is simply 1 divided by omega r squared minus capital omega squared. To understand the implications of this expression, let us look at one example. We will use the same example we used for the lecture on the frequency response function matrix for multi-degree of freedom systems. It's a 2-degree of freedom system with generalized coordinates x1 and x2, and these are absolute coordinates. Here you can find the parameters I used to do the calculations. And we are interested in understanding what the contribution of the eigenmodes of the system is to the frequency response function matrix. So the first thing we need is solve the eigenvalue problem to calculate these eigenfrequencies and eigenmodes. I did that, and this is the result. We have two eigenfrequencies, as you see on the screen, and that's what we expect because we have 2 degrees of freedom. And each of these eigenfrequencies has an associated eigenmode, and these eigenmodes are mass normalized. So from now, I will use red for the first eigenmode and blue for the second eigenmode. And let us see how these eigenmodes show up in the frequency response function expression. So the frequency response function matrix looks like this for a 2x2 system. And then we can write it as the sum of the contribution of the first mode, which is the modal frequency response function, and then this product of the eigencolumn, and the same for the second mode. And to make it even clearer, we will calculate this column matrix, sorry, this column row multiplication, and that is what I do now. So if I calculate this, I end up having two matrices. The first matrix is the contribution of the first mode, and the second matrix is the contribution of the second mode. And we see that for the contribution of the first mode, all elements have the same denominator, which is simply omega 1 squared minus capital omega squared. So this means all elements will have a peak at the eigenfrequency of the first mode, and the same here for the second mode. So the only difference is this part, the magnitude that comes from the elements of the eigenvector. Let us look at the plots to see how these equations play out. On this slide, we see the total frequency response functions of the matrix. Those are the blue lines, which are a little bit hidden. Here you see it better. The blue lines are the total responses. And then the red dashed lines are the contribution of mode 1, and the cyan dashed lines are the contributions of mode 2. And to better understand these plots, I will show the mathematical expressions used for the red lines. Those are the four mathematical expressions used for the red contributions, and these expressions are used for the cyan contributions. And in order to completely assess this plot, we would need to have the values of the eigenfrequencies and eigenmodes. So with this information, we have everything we need to understand the contributions of the modes. And I would like to ask you to pause this video and take some time to see whether you can understand the plot. Now I will continue with the interpretation. So the first thing we see when we look at this plot is that for most frequency response function matrix elements, the contribution of the first mode is practically identical to the total response for frequencies of, say, below 20 radians per second. For higher frequencies, as we see, then we clearly have the contribution of the second mode that appears. So if we concentrate on this region first, below 20 radians per second, what we see is that, for example, if we look at this first column, which is the contribution of force 1, force on mass 1, to the response. So response x1 is the first row and response x2 is the second row. What we see here is that if in this system we would only have a force acting on mass 1, then this first column would give us the response of the system. And then it's clear that it would be enough to have a model based on the first mode, so a 1 degree of freedom model, to accurately describe the response of both degree of freedom 1 and degree of freedom 2 at low frequencies. This is one way of looking at it. Another way of looking at this plot is, imagine we are trying to reduce the amplitude of oscillation of displacement 1 and displacement 2 due to a force F1 acting on mass 1. Then obviously we need to do something to reduce the response of mode 1 for both the first degree of freedom and the second degree of freedom. Acting on mode 2 would have no impact on the response of the system. So that's another way of looking at this plot. Then if we look only at the first row at displacement x1, and we go to the second column, which is the contribution of force 2, we see that here as well, mode 1 dominates in the low frequencies. So taking these two plots together, what this tells us is that for the first degree of freedom here, for the displacement of mass 1, even if we have a force 2 acting on the system, at low frequencies, we will have a very good description of what this mass 1 is doing if we consider only mode 1. So this gives us the possibility to reduce the size of our model, so to use less equations to describe the response. But of course, if we are interested in the higher frequency range, then we really need to consider the second mode, obviously, as you see here, because then we get in the region where we have this resonance of the second mode. The only response where the second mode is really significantly present is in the response of the second mass to a force acting on this mass. And this is something you possibly would expect. A last thing I want to note about this plot, and it's directly a question for you to think about, is that if you look, for example, here at the place where the two contributions of the modes cross, the sum of these contributions gives us the blue line, which is higher, right? But if we go to this other plot and we look again at this point where the two contributions are the same, the sum of these contributions suddenly gives us a result which is almost zero. And my question for you is, why is this? Why this difference? Thanks for watching. See you next time.